I give you praise for what you've done. I give you praise for you are able. I give you praise till I overcome. I give you praise when the sun is shining. I give you praise in the dark of night. I give you praise when the battle rages. I give you praise till it works out right. The shout of the King is among us. God is here in our praises. The shout of the King is among us. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in everything. I give you praise for you deserve it. I give you praise for what you've done. I give you praise for you are able. I give you praise that I overcome. I give you praise when the sun is shining. I give you praise in the dark of night. I give you praise when the battle rages. I give you praise till it works out right. The shout of the King is among us. God is here in our praises. The shout of the King is among us. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in every day. The shout of the King is among us. God is here in our praises. Shout of the King is among us. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in everything.
Oh, heaven open.
And heaven opens as we sing Your praise. Angels join us as we praise Your name. Is among us. God is here in our praises. The shout of the King is among us. Praise Him,
oh, the shout of the King.
The shout of the King is among us. God is here in our praises. The shout of the King is among us. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in everything. Praise Him in everything. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in everything.
Hallelujah. We want to welcome everybody, especially our visitors.
Hallelujah. We clap our hands in the sanctuary. Amen. We lift our hands. Here we go.
We lift our hands in the sanctuary. We lift our hands to give You the glory. We lift our hands to give You the praise, and we will praise You for the rest of our days. Yes, we will praise You for the rest of our days.
We clap our hands in the sanctuary.
We clap our hands to give You the glory. We clap our hands to give You the praise, and we will praise You for the rest of our days.
Hallelujah. We sing our song.
We sing our song in the sanctuary. We sing our song to give You the glory. We sing our song to give You the praise. And we will praise You for the rest of our days. Yes, we will praise You for the rest of our days. The rest of our days. Yes, we will praise You for the rest. holy in this place. You are worthy of my praise, and we worship you. Jesus, we worship you. You're the King of kings and Lord of lords. You're the Master of the universe. You're the ruler of all nations.
Mercy reigns.
this morning. Hallelujah. Lift up your voice. God, we worship.
Oh, Lord, we praise you this morning, worshiping your name. For you, oh God, are worthy to be exalted. You're worthy to be praised. Your name is above every name. Hallelujah, Lord, we thank you this morning. Thanking you for your love and forgiveness. Thank you for the brotherhood of the saints. Thank you for your healing and saving and delivering power, O Lord. Hallelujah, Rabba Shoro. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Lift up your voice. We are here to celebrate and offer thanksgiving and rejoice. Oh, God, we love you and need you and praise you. We exalt you today, oh God, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's lift up a number of needs this morning as we assemble here together to worship and to glorify the Lord. We want to remember those that are sick in their bodies. We're praying for Juan Baqueta for complete recovery in his body. We want to remember Pepe Siqueiros for healing and recovery and for him to come out of his very serious situation. We want to remember Mrs. Emler, Mary Reyna, Eric Guzman, that all need healing in their bodies. Jesus Molina, very seriously ill, needs a miracle of healing in his body as well. We want to remember to pray for Prescott Conference was last week. Three new international works were planted, as well as a number of domestic churches all over the United States. And we are praying for all of those, for God's grace and favor and blessing to continue to work in our fellowship. We want to pray for our church here in El Paso, services this morning and tonight, our city, that God would give us a breath of revival and open doors of opportunity to plant seeds in people's lives that will bear the fruit of repentance. We want to pray for our nation that is undergoing a transition of leadership. Incoming President Donald Trump will be inaugurated next Friday, and so we're praying for God's grace over President Obama and incoming President Trump and all the dynamics that are involved. We want to pray for all of our leaders all around our country, remembering also our military personnel in our church, those that are stationed here in El Paso, and those that are stationed around the world. We want to remember to pray for Cynthia Medina that has just been deployed to Poland. This is a brand new deployment, I believe, of 3,500 United States military personnel, and she's one of them. So we're praying for God's grace for her and for all of them in their new assignment there. We want to remember police officers, medical personnel, firemen, for God's grace over their lives. Let's pray for revival among our youth. God's grace throughout our church and our city to touch young men and women. We're praying for Pastor Mitchell, Pastor Harold and Mona Warner. Pastor Warner is in recovery, and he's actually preaching in El Paso this morning. In Tucson this morning. And Greg and Lisa Mitchell, we're praying for the grace of God over their lives. We want to remember some of our churches and missionaries, pastors and missionaries, Richard and Luz Contreras in Juarez, Mexico. We want to pray for her mother that's recovering from a heart attack, and I believe she's recovering well. Joe and Julie Stevens in Georgetown, Texas. Alex and Victoria Rodriguez in Thornton, Colorado. Troy and Christine Johnston in Tampa, Florida. We want to remember continuing to pray for Anthony Cobos for his situation, that God would give him grace and a quick release. We are praying for Maria Martinez, Jaime Martinez, Jesus Salas, the Batiste and Guzman families, those are all for salvation. There's so many other needs I know that are represented here today. You feel free to lift up those needs before the God who heals and who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think. You can cast all your cares upon him this morning because he cares for you. So let's touch heaven right now in prayer, lifting these needs up. Pray for the person next to you this morning. Lift up your own needs. And then our brother Caleb is going to come and open our service in prayer this morning. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for grace and favor, for blessing, for your authority, dominion, and anointing, for the power that is in the name of Jesus to save and to heal and to deliver, O God.
Father God, we come before you this morning and we have no confidence in our flesh, God. Our confidence is in you, Father. We pray that you would intervene in every need, God. We pray for healing for Pepe Siqueiros, God, for Juan, for Eric Guzman, Mary Reina. God, we pray that you would move in this place in our service, God. We pray for salvation, God. I pray that you would touch our country, God, and help us in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
God, take a moment, a quick one, to greet one another as you're getting seated. Amen. We want to welcome everybody out this morning. We're glad to be gathered together. As we have mentioned already, we just came back from our biannual Prescott Bible Conference and just had an extraordinary time of God moving, tremendous sermons. We're going to be hearing some of those in Sunday school starting in a few weeks when Brother Ernie finishes the series on where the Bible came from. So we'll be showing a few of those, and we're looking forward to that. But it was a fantastic conference. Pastor Mitchell preached two outstanding sermons on Monday and Friday, and all the others that contributed in ministry were just tremendous. And as I said, we had three new international works planted, and a lot of domestic churches, probably about 12 or 14 domestic churches planted. And so we're grateful for that report and for all that God's doing. We're going to hear a couple of reports in a moment from Victor Reyes and from Raymond and Marissa. And so they're going to get ready to come up quickly in just a moment. But a few announcements we want to make before that. We have a very powerful wedding tonight, and we are very much looking forward to that. Gabriel Ruiz and Melissa will be united in a Jesus People wedding. Our weddings are a regular church service, so even if you're new in the church, not really connected with the people in the wedding, you come to church tonight, it's a regular service. There's nothing different about the service, except we take a few minutes out in the middle of it to have a wedding and marry our couple. And that's it. Then we preach, we give an altar call, we try to get people saved, and we're going to be coming and worshiping God and receiving an offering and all the normal things that we do in a church service. So bring visitors tonight, bring people that need Jesus. And if you're new or newer in our congregation, we welcome you to come back to church tonight. We encourage you to get into the habit and the practice of coming to church twice on Sunday morning and evening. It's a different message and a different opportunity for God to do something very powerful in your life. The service tonight starts at 6:30. So take note of that. And then prayer meeting is at 5:30 in the sanctuary, because the fellowship hall is all set up for the reception that everyone in the church is invited to. There'll be a meal served tonight after the service. So we invite and encourage everyone to come and be part of that part of the service tonight. And it's a great fellowship we have. And even as I said, if you don't know, not really familiar with all that we do, you're welcome to come. It's a good way to get you folded into what we do as a church. So we welcome all of you. Amen. And then looking ahead into the week, we have prayer meetings every morning. The building is open from 6 to 9, and we are really serious about climate change in our church, in our families, in our own hearts, and in our nation. So we initiate climate change in prayer, and so I want to challenge you to come to prayer if you're able to in the morning. The building's open from 6 to 9, and I'm looking for new people that haven't been coming to start coming and get your new year started on your knees. That's the right position to start, and we have prayer meeting every morning from 6 to 9. Then on Tuesday night, we have women's prayer meeting at 6:30 here at the church. Wednesday, I'll be here preaching on Wednesday night. Our midweek service is at 7 p.m. So we encourage, again, everyone to come back to church on Wednesday. Again, it's another message and another great opportunity for God's work to continue in your life. On Thursday, we have our Spanish service and ministry, and we encourage those Spanish-speaking brethren to come to that. That is at 7 p.m. as well. This coming Friday, youth group will be meeting at 7:30 p.m. here at the church, and we encourage all of our youth and young people to come to that next Saturday. Prayer and outreach, 9 a.m. is prayer, 10 a.m. is outreach, and I want to really challenge everyone to be at the outreach that next Saturday. Bible study leaders and assistants, everyone that can. I've asked the staff to be on the outreach prayer. They're always here going on the outreach. We're going to test the waters for what we believe is going to happen, which is a new openness in the hearts of people to receive the gospel. And I believe we're going to see that happening next Saturday. You're going to discover people want to hear the gospel. You're going to be able to pray with people on the streets, doors that you knock on, wherever we happen to go. I believe God is doing something. And so I want to encourage everyone to come to prayer meeting 9 a.m. a week, next Saturday, and 10 a.m. outreach. And then, of course, the next day, we have revival starting with evangelist Jerry Fussell. I believe it's been about 5 years or so that he's been able to schedule us in and come back. He's very busy, travels all over the world. And we start revival on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Jerry is a genuine, anointed evangelist. It's a different ministry than a pastor. He has a gift to be able to come into a congregation, light fires, encourage people, communicate joy and victory, bring deliverance, get people filled with the Holy Ghost. And so he has a real dimension on his life and ministry. So you're not going to want to miss that. You're not going to want to be traveling arbitrarily out of town. You're going to want to be in every single one of those services, Sunday morning, 11 o'clock, Sunday night, 6:30, and Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday at 7, starting next Sunday. So that's going to be a powerful revival that we're looking forward to. There will be a water baptism 2 weeks from today on the 29th. New believers and those that have given their lives to Christ, take note of that. Bible study leaders meeting tonight, 6 p.m. in the Serious Men's Room. Spanish outreach tomorrow, 6 p.m. meeting here at the church. Song service practice Monday, also at 7 p.m. Our Sunday schedule begins with our serious men's class, and we're really looking forward this year to a very fruitful time. We're into our fifth year of doing that class. When I started it, my idea was to go six months off, but it just built momentum, and it's one of the very best things I've ever done. One of my favorite things in ministry has been that new believers, that serious men's class. And so we kind of started afresh this year after taking 2 weeks off because of Christmas Day and New Year's Day being on the Sunday. So I want to encourage men to come, be part of that. And I do need to get you to be on time for that class. It's very frustrating for those who get up early, pay the price, get here early and on time, and then we have to wait a few minutes for everyone to show up. At first, when we started, I said we're slamming the doors shut at 7:30, but I've had mercy and grace since then. But we really do need you to make an effort to be on time. You can do it. So please help us to be on time. That way we can start that class with a full house. And then, of course, after that 7:30 Serious Men's class, we have prayer meeting at 9 here a.m. every Sunday morning. Ernie's going to be finishing his Sunday school up, I think, in the next 2 weeks, two. I think we talked about two. Yeah, you have to do two. Thus says the Lord, your God. Anyway, he's going to be teaching that class for the next 2 weeks. Then we're going to show a couple of videos, and then we're going to start a class called Fiscal Fitness that I'm going to teach on financial blessing and responsibility. So you're not going to want to miss that. That's looking ahead a little bit. All right, let's hear a report from Caleb about a breakthrough concert last night that happened. And so he's going to share with us what God did at the edge.
We had just an awesome night at the Edge last night. We had probably about 10 visitors. It was good music. We had a new group. We had awesome testimonies. It was just a really, really good night. And you throw in some preaching, and you have like 7 people that prayed last night. It was a very, very awesome night. I just want to encourage everybody to come out tomorrow. Saturday, 8:00. We have another concert. You don't want to miss it. We got two groups. It's going to be really good. It's free. It's family oriented. You can come, you can bring your kids or snacks. It's all good music. So I want to encourage you, don't want to miss it this coming Saturday, 8:00 p.m. in this very building. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's going to be, as the ushers are coming, a very important Edge ministry meeting next Sunday, 4:30 p.m., mandatory for all those that are involved in the Edge. Bands, drama, lighting, sound, preachers. And so it's the meeting is also open if you want to get involved in our Edge Saturday night concert ministry. So if you want to come along, you're newer in the church and you want to be part of that, see what's happening and what you may be able to contribute. That'll be next Sunday, very important meeting at 4:30. And then we have an invasion team, impact team, going to Northeast El Paso 2 weeks from yesterday, Saturday, January 28th. And we need you to sign up for that so we know how many are going. And then in the next few services, we'll give you instructions about what time and so forth. It'll be meeting over there in the morning, Saturday, 2 weeks from yesterday, impact team to the Northeast. So please take note of that. Amen. We want to take time to worship God, which is what offerings are all about. It's worship. It's love. It's vision. It's obedience. It's a way that you connect your heart with the heart of God. When you love what He loves, it results in liberality in giving because the work of God requires finances and resources, and God has structured His kingdom to operate on earth in such a way so as to utilize the finances that He blesses you with to facilitate the work of God. That's how it works. The work of God is advanced not through the millionaire or the person who can finance it all by themselves, but it's the money in the hands and in the pocketbooks and in the bank accounts of single mothers, single men and women, married couples. You may not be earning a ton of money, but it's your tithes and your offerings. When we pool all that together, it facilitates our ability to do what we do. Not only financing and supporting the church here in El Paso, but you know we spend $50,000 a month in sending resources all over the world, financing churches and missionaries from Africa to Europe to China to South America to Central America to Mexico, Ireland. We're heavily involved. We don't do it as a token. We train workers right out of our church, and then we send them, and then we support them. They don't have to hustle their own money. They don't have to come back every 6 months and figure out a way how they're going to finance their ministry. We send them money. They're able to stay in place and do the work of God. So this requires a huge commitment on our part of pledging money, giving our tithes, giving offerings besides. So I want to challenge you to bless the kingdom today. Align your heart with the heart of God, and let's work together to advance God's kingdom. Amen. I'm going to ask if Brother Mark Hernandez would pray and ask the Lord to bless gift and giver.
Look what the Lord has done.
Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. I'm gonna praise His name. He's evermore the same. Come on and praise Him. Look what the Lord has done. Come on and praise Him. Look what the Lord has done.
Amen. While Victor Reyes and Raymond and Marissa are coming to the platform, I'd like you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis 14. We're going to preach there in just a moment. Where's Victor? Victor, Raymond, and Marissa, come to the platform. Amen. You guys might as well go first. Hallelujah.
My name is Raymond Hernandez, and this is my wife, Marissa. It's my first time ever going to a Prescott conference. Wow. And, you know, when we went in there, the first thing right off the bat that Pastor Mitchell talked about was about prayer. And it hit me because usually when we're here in prayer and stuff like that, we sit there. And he says it's not a meditation. We don't meditate, we pray. That means that when we're in there, we're dealing with God and we voice it out loud. That means people hear us. And the things that we say and that we do. And it struck me because when I came, I would come with my mom before I went to when I was going to high school. I would come to prayer first. Then I would go to high school. And if you've been here in this church, you know how my mom prays when she speaks in tongues. It's very loud. And that struck me because, you know what? That's how I learned how to pray. You have to voice it out. You have to cry out to God. And then when I started coming in the morning, when I'd go to work, I hear another person praying. That's my pastor, Pastor Stevens. He voices out loud too. And when we sit here, we don't sit here and we just meditate. That's what he said. We don't sit here and meditate. He said when people heard him pray, that's how they found out how to pray, by his leadership. So when we come to prayer, as Pastor also preached about the climate change, we have to pray to get a climate change within us so that we can be able to affect other people. And so that dealt with me really, really deep, is that when I pray, I am laying a hold of God in the morning. And when I get out of here, it's something that needs to be changed in me. And another thing was offering, giving. When they're taking up the offering, I looked to my wife and I would tell her, you know, the first time, oh, we give this amount, okay, that's cool. The second night he was dealing with me and I was like, I'm going to have a fight. I know I am. I'm going to tell my wife this much and it's not going to be. And so I told her and she's like, okay. And that struck me. I was like, she said it was fine, like no argument, no nothing. And then the third night, I was like, all right, let's do it again. And we did it, and she was like, okay with it. And I found it was me. I was the one that wanted the argument because I didn't want to do it. I was like, no, I don't want to give this much. And throughout my entire life, I've been taken care of, and that's because I was growing up in this church, and my parents believe in God. And I've always been taken care of. And me and Pastor McLeese, I had the privilege of traveling with him everywhere. And he was saying, you know, in Luke chapter 4, it says that God went up to the synagogue and he read a scripture from the Bible. And he was saying that I am the one that's going to fulfill this scripture. And the Pharisees got upset. They were going to get him and they were going to throw him out. They were going to lead him to a cliff and push him off. But it says at the very end that he just walked through the crowd and was free. They didn't. I guess he just walked through and stuff. And so what Pastor Baglisi said is, like, people are scared of flying and stuff because they may die. They're going to crash or something like that. But it's the thing that if we're in the will of God, God knows our time, and he knows when we will pass away. So when we give in faith to Jesus, he's going to take care of us if it's his will and the things that we are doing. If we are in the right track, then he will take care of us no matter what. It's the one that's not in God's will that's going to be afraid and will not give. And so I'm challenging this church, first of all, prayer and in our giving. We need to have this next conference. Pastor said he's going to bring everyone that's pioneering back or that's overseas back. We need to fulfill that so that they get here, they hear the word of God, they feel the fire, and then we can go ahead and reach the world again.
Honestly, going into this conference, I've been into conferences before, but it's very different being married because there's a different aspect. You're going in as a married couple and you're doing God's will together. And being in different ministries, we've been in ministries together since before we got married. And when we took over the youth, I remember being very scared, being assistants to Caleb and Brenda and having to be, I knew I had to be an example, and I always tried my best, but I just had a fear. And at conference, God really told me, like, give it to me, because he has me in this place for a reason. And the pastors were saying, like, if he didn't want you there, he wouldn't have put you there. And if you're going to be there, he will equip you to be in that position to help the youth. And it really struck me, like, sometimes I could have a bad attitude, like frustrations would just get to me, but I had to realize, like, I need to give it to God, and he will use me to help the youth and to make it grow. And I learned, like, I really need to have faith to believe in him, that God can stir a revival amongst the youth, because I'm still 19 and I can connect with them because we are around the same age. And I just felt like God was telling me, you need to believe in me that I can change the atmosphere and I can bring the climate change, as Pastor Stevens preached about, and that we can really have revival in the youth. And I just needed to give it to him. And I want to encourage you, like, if you've never been to a conference, you should make an effort to go, even if it's a few days, because the presence at a conference is very different, and you can feel God's presence everywhere in the prayer room, in the services, and he will touch your life. And I just want to encourage you to do that.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Victor Reyes. I promise I've been in this church for a long time. He didn't sponsor a new convert. Having lived in Oklahoma, I mentioned this to Pastor Glenn last night. I haven't been in a conference since El Paso 2014. So I've gone almost 3 years without sitting in a conference. And I figured, you know what, I sit in church, I worship God, prayer life, the whole deal, and it's fine. But when Pastor told me I was going to get sponsored to Prescott, I immediately got a little nervous because I was cutting a week out of my Christmas vacation. But I hadn't been to a conference in a while. And I didn't know what to expect. Monday night, right off the bat, Pastor Mitchell preached one of the best sermons I've ever heard. A classic, like Raymond said, on prayer. But what really struck me, and I think, for a lot of us who were there, I think you can attest to this. Tuesday night, Pastor Joe Campbell, in the 10 years that I've been in this fellowship, I have never, ever been through a service like that. From the the song service to the preaching to the altar call. It was something else. There was a presence there like I've never felt before. And in my life, there was a lot of things that I realized I had to deal with. The sermon was on broken chains and things that were holding you down. Pastor Ruby's sermon on vision, he ministered a lot to younger people. And then I'm biased, but Pastor Stephen's sermon on Friday was, he preached it here in El Paso, so I heard it twice, but it was so much better in Prescott Conference, and it was a different dynamic to it. Being, like Marissa said, there's a different dynamic and a different presence when you're in the conference, and I think that, you know, led into Pastor's sermon. And, you know, again, I just want to thank, you know, the El Paso Church, Pastor Stevens, for allowing me to go, for sponsoring me. I know, you know, it was a tremendous blessing in my life, and I'm so grateful. Unfortunately, I will not be, you know, keeping that spirit here, as he says. I got to take it back home, but I'm excited to take it home. I've already spoken to my pastor in Oklahoma, talked to him about some of the things that I want to do differently in my life, and I wanted him to hold me accountable. So I just want to thank you guys again. You know, again, it was a great week of conference, other than pastor waking me up at 5:30 in the morning every day to go have breakfast. But it was awesome. So I just want to thank everyone. So thank you, Pastor.
If you're going to change the world, you got to get up early. Amen. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Genesis 14 if you haven't already done so. I want to preach on a subject that I do every January, at least sometime in the month of January, as well as at other times in the year, but I always feel impressed to preach on this subject in January. January is an interesting month simply by virtue of the fact that it is the first month of the year, and traditionally, whether it's a business or your life, we take inventory. We tend to think about our lives in January and what should change and what we should try and leave behind in the previous year, and we think in terms of making resolutions or trying to change things in our lives that haven't been quite right. It might be a relational issue that you need to fix in your life. You don't want to carry bitterness from one year to the next. It might be issues concerning your marriage. I'm going to be ministering on a marriage sermon tonight called Love, Lost, and Found. It may be an issue in your marriage relationship that needs to be fixed. I mean, may need to really work on your marriage this year. There may be habits, bad ones, that have to be shed and left behind, and new ones that are healthy and good and spiritual habits that need to be initiated. A lot of people at this time resolve to improve their health. I read that 40% of the business in health clubs is done in January and February. What happens after February? We all know they quit, but at least they try to get the ball rolling. One advertisement for this New Year's thing that people get onto and they go and membership up at the gym, one gym said, "You're inches away from paradise." That's what it says. Another said, "Have a merry fitness and a happy new rear." And then January 16th has been recognized as the day when most people give up on their resolutions because their nature is taking them in one direction toward things that are not good and unhealthy. They're trying to generate some, they can't pull it off. So January 16th is recognizes the day most people give up their resolutions, and 1 week from tomorrow has been designated as the most depressing day of the year because people are wallowing in the failure of broken resolutions, maybe some debt from Christmas and unwise spending. So we believe that a week from tomorrow can be the best day of the year, but this is how the world thinks about things. So there's another very important area that I want to focus on, and that is the financial realm. The financial realm, handling money, is a place that we make a lot of mistakes. We get in a lot of trouble when it comes to money, how we think about it, the decisions that we make regarding it, and then how we spend it and how we use it. People get into debt. People get into criminal types of behavior. The love of money is the root of all evil, the Bible says. An inordinate affection for money can get you into a lot of trouble in life. So I think January is also a good time to get our financial house in order. And I want to read from a text that I've not used before on this particular subject, but it's the first place where tithing is mentioned in the Bible. I've referred to it before, but never used it as a text that I can remember. And so this text pulls back the curtain on a struggle that every one of us has to deal with on a regular and a continual basis to be faithful to God, faithful with the resources that He's placed in our hands, stewardship over the material interests of our lives reaches into every part of your character and every area of your life. And I want to preach a message I've entitled The Tale of Two Kings, T-A-L-E, not T-A-I-L, The Tale of Two Kings. Let's look at the few scriptures I want to read, beginning in Genesis chapter 14, verse 16. So Abraham brought back all the goods. And he also brought back his brother Lot and his goods, as well as the women and all the people. And the king of Sodom, this is one of the two kings. The king of Sodom went out to meet him in the valley of Seva after his return from the defeat of Chedorlaomer and the kings who were with him. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, that's our second king, brought out bread and wine. He was the priest of God Most High. And the king of Salem blessed Abraham and said, "Blessed be Abraham of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand." And so Abraham gave him a tithe of all. Now the king of Sodom said to Abraham, "Give me the persons, take the goods for yourself." But Abraham said to the king of Sodom, "I have raised my hand to the Lord, God Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth, and I will take nothing from a thread to a sandal strap, and that I will not make anything that is yours, lest you should say, I will not take anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abraham rich, except only what the young men have eaten and a portion of the men who went with me. Let them take their portion." God's covenant with Abraham is then described in chapter 15, verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, saying, "Do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield and your exceeding great reward." So we have quite a fascinating story here that requires parsing and analysis, and I hope I can present revelation that will move your heart today. I want to talk about financial blessing. Let's talk about that. Financial blessing is something that we desire. It's something that we long for. We strive for it. We pray for it. We work for it. We go to school for it. We pray. Promises of God, faith, provision, and so forth. So that impulse that we have to accumulate material wealth, money and finance, and to increase is something that God put in the human heart. There's nothing wrong with it. Think about how God made nature to work and operate. The first businesses in the Bible were the farmer and the herdsman. They discover, you plant and you reap this incredible, abundant harvest. One seed can grow an apple tree that can produce 200 apples in a season. And those 200 apples will produce about 2,000 seeds that can be planted. And you can see the abundance and the multiplication that God intended his creation to enjoy. They figure out, if I plant more, I get more. If I get more boy and girl sheep together, I'm going to have more sheep. So let's figure out which is which, and let's get them married and send them on a honeymoon. Our text begins at the end of a battle that Abraham has fought against the five kings of Canaan, who, among other things, had attacked Sodom, where Lot was living, taken Abraham's nephew captive. And so Abraham, with a force of 318 men, goes after the five kings, who no doubt had a much larger force, and he defeats them, subjugates them, brings them to surrender. And as a result of that, he gains an incredible financial windfall and blessing. He defeated the adversaries, liberated the hostages, and as a result, he accumulates and acquires all of this wealth. In verse 16, where we started reading, the Bible says that Abraham brought back all the goods. That word goods means riches, substance, movable goods, whatever they could take with them, livestock and utensils. It was vast wealth and vast resource that came into Abraham's possession as a result of doing the work of God. Abraham is in the will of God, doing the work of God, and he ends up blessed financially. He wasn't chasing after money. He wasn't pursuing wealth. It's not greed and avarice that was driving him. He was trying to rescue his nephew and right this injustice. And as a result of that, this financial windfall comes his way. Matthew 6, this principle is inserted throughout the Word of God. Therefore, do not worry, saying what we shall eat, what we shall drink, what we shall wear, for your heavenly Father knows that you need these things. Seek first the kingdom of God. Prioritize pursuing the will of God above everything else, and all of these things shall be added to you. We don't chase after money as an objective in and of itself. We pursue the will of God, and as a result of pursuing the will of God, he blesses. He pours out his Spirit. The abundance of the earth comes into your possession. It shall be added to you. It's a little bit like the random arrow. Remember that random arrow in the book of the Kings that ends up killing Ahab? God wanted to judge Ahab, needed to judge Ahab. And the Bible says it was a random arrow that was shot by the enemy. They weren't aiming at anything, only over there where the enemy was. And that arrow found its way between a chink in Ahab's armor, and that arrow killed him. And Abraham is judged because that archer hit something he wasn't aiming at. Making money is not the goal, nor is it the objective of the believer. Doing the will of God is. This is why it's disturbing when people embrace the rationale. Well, you know, I can make more money here. Doesn't God want me to do and to go and to involve myself in whatever will enrich me the most? Not necessarily. Maybe, but not necessarily, because making money, having money, earning money, accumulating wealth is not the primary objective of the believer. Doing the work and the will of God is. In the case of the rich young ruler, Jesus doesn't view being in position to have the most amount of money as the objective of life, because he told this rich young ruler, you lack one thing, sell what you have, distribute it to the poor, and come and follow me. That was the will of God. And in order to do the will of God, he had to walk away from the wealth, because that's not the objective of life. 1 Timothy puts it this way. Those who desire to be rich, in other words, if that's your objective and your goal, and somehow the will of God has to cooperate with that objective, then you're going to find yourself in trouble one day. Those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, into many foolish and harmful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith. So, in other words, your appetite for money, if it's above the will of God, is going to lure you away from the faith. In their greediness, they have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Listen to how the Amplified Bible translates that. But those who crave to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish, useless, and godless lusts and desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction and miserable perishing. For the love of money is the root of all evils. It is through this craving that some have been led astray and have wandered from the path of faith and pierced themselves through with many acute mental pangs and anguish. That's what happens when you chase money over the will of God. If that's the objective, you're eventually going to find yourself out of the will of God. Proverbs 11 says, there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. Again, so one is making it the objective to hold, to accumulate, to have, to possess resource, wealth, and money. But the Bible says that can lead to poverty because it's become the objective of a man's heart, and it has loosed all sorts of deficient characteristics, greed and avarice and so forth. Money's not our goal. But as you prioritize the will of God, the Bible's very clear. You get blessed. God adds. Abraham acquired as a result of pursuing God's will first and foremost. He was blessed. See, this is the fruit of salvation. And it only makes sense, because God is a God of abundance. And he wants to bless you. He wants to enrich you in every way, spiritually. He's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, the Bible says in Ephesians 3. So God is able to make vast deposits of spiritual life and power and grace and love and forgiveness to the point you feel like you can't take anymore. And this is also true in the material and the financial realm. Look at the world and the earth that God created. It is full and it is bursting with all kinds of wealth and fruitfulness and resources. God has created a world of abundance for the purpose of blessing those whom he creates. He wants to meet your needs. He wants to channel wealth into your hands. He wants to give you, and he wants to provide for the advance of the kingdom of God around the world. When we need money, or I'm praying for money and resources for the work of God, I don't pray and say, God, give us money. I pray and say, God, bless the saints. Bless the wage earner and the salesman and the businessman and the investor. God, pour out blessing so that they can give, and then there'll be abundance in the house of God. Proverbs 13:22, a good man leaves an inheritance for his children, his children's children, but the wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous. That means that all wealth that's being accumulated around the world, at God's discretion, he can begin to pull it out of the hands of the unbeliever and channel it into the hands of the righteous when God knows they're going to use it to advance his purpose because of burden and vision and a longing to advance the will of God. God has that ability to wrestle wealth from and to you. God is a blesser and he is a provider. Philippians 4:19, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches. Do you not think that he's capable and that he is able? He'll supply all your need according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. God is a blesser. God is a God of abundance. God is a provider. There is what I want to call today a salvation dividend. Dividend. A dividend is a benefit that comes from an action or a policy. The way that we understand dividend is that it is a sum of money paid out by a company to its shareholders. You buy stock, and some stocks, I don't understand how it all works, have attached to them dividends that can come as the stock does well. You've invested in that company. You're helping them fulfill their agenda. And so they release some of the profits of investment back into your hand. Synonyms for the word dividend are benefit and action gained or bonus or extra. Salvation pays bountiful dividends, and you should say amen. You were going to hell, now you're going to heaven. That's a dividend. You were powerless in your life, now you're filled with the Holy Ghost. That's a dividend. You were walking around brainless, dunces like I was, we get saved. Now we're students of God's word, and we can receive revelation straight from God's throne. On the night of their deliverance, the children of Israel, they've been slaves for 400 years. They don't own property, not allowed to. God delivers them, but they have no resources. They have no wealth for their journey. And then God tells them, you go into the neighborhoods of the Egyptians and you watch what I'm going to do. And so this ragtag bunch of slaves dressed in their slave garments, everybody knew who the Jews were. They lived in their own area. They were slaves. Now they're streaming into the neighborhoods of the upper crust of the Egyptians. And they knock on their doors. And God opens the heart of the Egyptians. And they allow them to come in and take from their homes what ever they wished, because God can take wealth from one and put it into the hands of another. Now the children of Israel did according to the word. They asked from the Egyptians articles of silver and articles of gold and clothing, and the Lord gave them favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that the Egyptians granted them what they requested, and thus they plundered the Egyptians, and they walked out of Egypt with both arms filled, their wagons, whatever articles they had to carry materials with. They were wealthy and they were abundantly blessed because God is a blesser. And when you're doing the will of God, he wants to bless you. I want to talk about three reasons why this is so. Dividends that begin to come your way as a result of your salvation. The first is the tithe. And I'll get to more of this in a moment. I never heard, at least as far as I'm aware, the word tithe before I became a Christian. It was completely new to me. But I heard about it. I'm saved. It bears witness in my spirit, bore witness in the heart of my wife. We began to tithe, recognizing that it was obedience, recognizing that it was worship and love, recognizing that we were connecting ourselves with the heart of God. Bring all the tithes, Malachi 3:10. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house, says the Lord. And try me now in this, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. That's a dividend. You obey God in the tithe, and he blesses you in so many ways. The God's Word translation of that verse, bring one-tenth of your income into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. Test me in this way, says the Lord. See if I won't open the windows of heaven for you and flood you with blessings. Our text is the first record of tithing, or the first time the word tithing is used in the Bible, and the first record of tithing. And so I thought about that. How did this come about? Because there's nothing about tithing before this. There's no edict, no commandment, no word from God, no instructions. Abraham did this instinctually. And we'll learn more about that in just a moment. Nobody told him, just like Noah, when he came out of the ark and he built an altar to the Lord. Nobody told him to do that. God didn't instruct him. All the instruction for altars, all the instructions for tithing came much later. And there were a lot of instructions about it, but none here. Abraham instinctually tithed. Now we can see that powerful revelation is at working in his heart. For him to have this instinct, he's flowing in the stream of a principle and a powerful dimension of God's will that he intends to institute at a later time. Not instituted yet, but Abraham by revelation. And the Bible says in our text in verse 19, and he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And he gave him the tithe of all. When my wife and I began to tithe, I was earning $2.65 an hour, minimum wage, paying rent out of that, paying our bills out of that. My wife and I began to tithe. And certainly, it's not a lot of money, but we began to tithe. And by virtue of doing that, we tapped into the dividend of God's blessing and favor that is poured out over the faithful tither. And my wife and I cannot fathom not paying our tithes. It's not possible for me to get money and not separate 10%. It has become, over the many years that we've been Christians, it has become the character of how we, part of how we conduct ourselves in the financial realm. The second dividend as a result of salvation is that no longer are you going to have to pay any sin tax. How many know what sin tax is? You don't? That's what your sin cost you. How many had a lot of expense connected with your sin? Sin tax is actually a term. And it is a levy that is placed by either state or local or federal governments on vices. Items that are considered undesirable or harmful or unhealthy or dangerous, like alcohol and tobacco, there is a what's called a sin tax that is placed on those items. And in some cases, some of that sin tax, if you can rationalize the insanity of this, goes to helping alcoholics and people that are dying because of tobacco and nicotine and all of their addictions. And the point of that is that sin will cost you. When you get saved, you no longer have to pay a sin tax. You paid a very hefty one. Some of you paid a hefty. You paid more sin tax than any tithe will ever be. A whole paycheck could go on a Friday night. Anybody here that happened to? And even more sin tax Now, a woman having a flow of blood, Luke 8, for 12 years, who had spent all her livelihood on physicians, could not be healed, came behind Jesus and touched the border of his garment and was immediately healed. So as a result of that healing, she no longer has to pay out money to the physicians. She's healed now. Using that as a physical illustration of the spiritual sickness, we think that somehow if we buy this and if we do that and if we go here and it all costs money, we're trying to satisfy our sick, sin-laden hearts by spending money. And it all goes for naught because nothing satisfies. Only Jesus Christ can satisfy. And when you get saved, no more sin tax. And you ought to be grateful for that. The third dividend is that God will make you into a good worker instead of the lazy slugs that we once were. If somebody hired us in the past, it was only because they didn't know us. Whether you're a wage earner here today, a tradesman, a salesman, a businessman, an investor, salvation will enable you to tap potential that never would have been realized. Sin darkens the atmosphere of your creativity. You take away the darkness, and all of a sudden men and women get inspired about different ways to earn and make money and work, and we become diligent and we become faithful and we become the best employers, the best employees rather, on the job. Deuteronomy affirms this and says, remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth. That's a dividend of our salvation, is God changes our character, opens up the windows of creativity, and all of a sudden we're inspired, we're motivated, we're pursuing the will of God as the first priority, and he blesses us with ability in the financial realm. Let's look at these two kings, these two visitors that came to Abraham. It's very interesting who shows up when Abraham has all this wealth. And there's a choice that always comes when you're holding your paycheck. Abraham's holding quite a hefty paycheck. And the two kings come at that moment. And this illustrates something that happens to every one of us. Whenever you've been blessed financially, whenever payday comes around, whenever resources come into your hands, however that might come about, these two kings will always make it. They're waiting for it. They're waiting for the money to be transferred into your bank account. They're waiting for the mailman to drop off the paycheck. And then when you're holding the resource, these two kings make their appearance. Verse 17, the king of Sodom went out to meet Abraham. And verse 18, the king of Salem brought out bread and wine. Now, these two kings are polar opposites. They represent two kingdoms. They represent the interests of two different kingdoms. And they appear when you're holding money. There is a spiritual dimension connected to your having, handling, and having possession of money. When it comes, if it's still in the boss's bank account or waiting to be transferred, not an issue. It's when it comes into your hands, then these two kings will make their appearance. And it is at that moment that your spirit, the kind of man or woman that you are, the attitudes that drive and define how you handle money and the decisions you make are going to come to the forefront. And these are indicators of the kind of heart you have. And whether you are submitted to the king of Salem or the king of Sodom, it is going to become apparent when you have the wealth. They didn't make the appearance before the battle, before Abraham got this windfall. Only after do they make their appearance and start making their appeals. Jesus spoke about these two kingdoms in Luke 16, 13. No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. The word mammon literally means treasure or riches. And by the decisions that we make, when we have money like Abraham did, whether it's a paycheck or a windfall of financial blessing, you are going to demonstrate to which king you are submitted to. When you submit to the king of Sodom, and I'll describe him in a moment, when you submit to what Jesus called the king of Sodom, which is mammon, it will make demands on you that will contradict the will of God and lead you down the road of a curse hovering over your life. When you're holding money, your love for God is going to be challenged. And it's possible for us to be demonstrating that we love money more than we love God. We demonstrate that by the decisions that we make when we have money. If you don't tithe, and you know better, you've already had the revelation of it in times past, maybe shortly after conversion or sometime after conversion, revelation came. You saw the spiritual rationale and the benefit and the blessing of tithing. If you don't tithe and you know better, you have in the past by revelation, you have turned now to the God of mammon. There's no nice way for me to say it. That's the clearest way that I can communicate what's happened. The rich young ruler that I referred to already was caught between these two kingdoms. Jesus said, follow me. Sell what you have, distribute it to the poor, come and follow me. But he had possession of great riches. He had it. It was his. It was in his account, in his house. And he's caught between these two kings. So let's meet them. We need to get to know them a little better. The first one is the king of Salem. He has two other titles in our text, and one other title in Hebrews, which I'll read in a moment. He's referred in our text as the priest of the Most High God and the king of righteousness. Hebrews puts it this way: for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the battle of the kings and blessed him, to whom also gave Abraham also gave a tenth part of all, first being translated king of righteousness, and then also of Salem, meaning king of peace, without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but Melchizedek, made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. So it's very evident that this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, is an Old Testament type of Jesus, may even have been a manifestation of Jesus himself, represents the interests of God's kingdom when you come into the possession of money. In our text, then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was the priest of the Most High God. The king of Salem is coming now to celebrate with Abraham. Abraham has obeyed God, and he has done the will of God, and the blessing of wealth and resources come his way. And the Melchizedek, the king of Salem, comes out to meet him, and they celebrate. It's like he's saying to Abraham, we did it. We accomplished this together. And it was Abraham that separated a tenth and gave that tenth to the king of Salem, because it was the king of Salem, as he acknowledges, that facilitated his victory, that helped him to overcome. The reason the wealth is in my hands is not because of my genius, it's because of him, and the tithe is going to recognize that. And so he separated a tenth of all that he had gained, of all the increase, and he put it into the hands of the king of Salem. Abraham recognizes that by tithing, he is honoring Melchizedek. Remember, he did this instinctually. He did this by revelation. Because from his perspective, as he has all this wealth, and here is the priest of the Most High God, the only right thing to do is to share in the wealth and recognize him and honor him. And he separated a tenth part because he deemed it was the only right thing to do. Let's meet the king of Sodom. The king of Sodom represents the polar opposite. We all know about Sodom. Sodom is the city where Lot fled to. It was a city of wickedness, sexual perversion. It was a city of avarice. And Lot chose Sodom for a reason, because in Sodom there was lots of money, and that was attractive to Lot. Look what happened to Lot. If you read the narrative, we don't have time to go into all the verses. You can read it later. But Lot got a position in Sodom. The Bible says he sat in the gate, which means that he had a position of authority, and that would have been surrounded by wealth. Plus, the Bible tells us that he had a house. He didn't have a house when he was wandering around in a tent with Abraham. But in Sodom, he got a nice, big house. He's enjoying himself. Whenever you find money being revered as a god, or whenever you find money as the priority above the will of God, and you find a man or a woman who can't make a decision, it's always more money that wins out. You'll find compromise. You'll find all manner of sin and degradation. Eventually in Sodom, there was perversion, there was immorality. You see things like gambling and drugs, drug use and drug addiction. All of those go hand in hand when you submit yourself to the king of Sodom. Look at what he said. The king of Sodom represents Mammon, and his message is the opposite of the king of Salem. He said, give me the persons and take all the goods for yourself. Keep it all. That's what he said. Give me the souls, because that's what's valuable to him. He wanted people, not things. You get things anyway. Abraham, you keep it all. Think about yourself. Have it for yourself. Think about all that you can do. I want the people. It's another way of saying, don't tithe, Abraham. Keep it all for yourself. When you are under the influence of the king of Sodom, when you get money, you always think of yourself first. That's the king of Sodom's message. Think of yourself. Keep it all for yourself. You have so many needs, you can't afford to tithe. You don't need to honor Melchizedek, the priest of the Most High God. Give me the souls, keep the substance, because under his word and his authority, you're going to think of yourself first. When you don't tithe, you're selling your soul for substance. I know that sounds extreme, but that's essentially what's happening. Hell wants your soul. Hell wants the people. And in order for him to get that, he has to get you to keep it all. It's a trade and it's an exchange. You can't say, for example, that you have a love for God's people, that you have a genuine vision if you don't tithe. You know, one of the most wicked industries is the casino gambling industry. They make the lion's share of their profits from people like you who are addicted to gambling. who get in debt, who lose marriages and homes, who become estranged from their children, who end up in prison sometimes because of the criminal activity they'll get to try to feed their addiction habit. But casinos are in business to make money, and they end up with the soul of the individual by ruining people's lives, by allowing them a forum to feed their gambling addiction. That is such a contempt for people, to exploit them to that degree. If you've ever been in a casino, you know that a casino has no windows and no clocks. They don't want you to notice when the sun comes up or when it goes down. They don't want you to see what time it is. If you're a gambling addict, the adrenaline flows. You lose track of time and you end up bankrupt. That's their business plan. That's their business model. That is their strategy. You're not going to win. You're going to lose your soul. Psalms 49:6. Those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother nor give to God a ransom for him. There's going to be a lot of loss because of the king of Sodom, because although he didn't convince Abraham, he convinces a lot of others. Keep it all for yourself. I don't want stuff. I want the souls of men and women. So don't tithe, keep it, don't advance the interests of God's kingdom. And the devil knows that if he can tie up the pockets of God's people, he can gain souls. So let me close by talking about the right choice. Because many of us have a decision to make today. Honoring God with the tithe will protect you from the tyranny of the king of Sodom. By the spirit you are of, and the choices that you make, you can be subjugated by this unrighteous, demonically inspired tyrant. The king of Sodom is a tyrant. He will ruin your life. What you think you're keeping by virtue of holding on to everything and not tithing, you're going to lose eventually anyway. That's what Malachi says. Bring all the tithes, and I will then rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. Whatever you think you're gaining by not tithing, you will eventually lose. Not even the king of Sodom himself can prevent that from happening. Abraham resisted. And in the face of the king of Sodom, he said, "No, sir." And the Bible says, "I raised my hand to the Most High God." He did that right in the presence of the king of Sodom. And by the time the king of Sodom made his appeal, Abraham had already tithed, had already settled the issue, like you need to settle the issue today before the king of Sodom comes and starts appealing to your nature. You will never be a faithful tither unless you decide beforehand. Well, let me see how things go this week, and then when I get my paycheck, I'm going to decide then whether or not I can tithe. If you do that, you're going to end up subjugated by the king of Sodom, and you're going to end up losing. You have to decide beforehand, no matter what increase, no matter what wealth, no matter what resource, no matter what raise, no matter what return on investment comes my way, I am tithing without thinking about it, without pondering or weighing everything in the balance, without considering anything else. I am honoring God because it is by virtue of his grace over my life that I'm holding this today. Abraham is rewarded and blessed. Verse 1, and I close with this. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. After these things, he's tithed. And then the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, saying, "Don't be afraid. I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward." Listen, when you obey God in the tithe, he gets close to you. What it says. The Lord came to Abraham. God sees this incredible revelation working in his heart that he's going to introduce later and make it an institutional principle of how God's people are to handle their money. But he sees Abraham doing this beforehand by revelation, and he comes to him. He gets close. The word came to Abraham, means to abide, to remain, or continue. It's the idea of a permanent closeness that you wouldn't otherwise enjoy. When you tithe, you have the opportunity to live a life absent of fear. When you trust God, which tithing is an expression of trusting God, God says to Abraham, do not be afraid. Putting your affairs in his hands by tithing gives you a confidence. And my wife will tell you, I can testify that when we've been in financial straits, and we could have used all that came in, but we tithed, there's a confidence. There's a favor that you feel and sense from God when you obey him, when it's hard to obey, and when it's challenging to obey, and when it's difficult to obey, and when it's a great sacrifice to obey. And the Bible says he also becomes our shield. I am your shield, a protector. God will protect. Keep the devourer from eating away at your resources, your wealth, and your finances. And it opens the door for God to become your provider. You want to be your own provider? Be my guest. But if you want God to take over the control of how wealth flows into your hands, that's what Abraham did. And the Bible says, I am your exceedingly great reward. He's a God of abundance. If he had said, I am your great reward, that would have been fine. But he said, I'm your exceedingly great reward. And so we learn this incredible lesson. Two kings approach. You're going to interact with each. Which one are you going to submit to? The king of Sodom or the king of Salem? Let's bow our heads this morning. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Nobody moving around for a moment. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace and your love. Thank you for this people that have gathered together today. Let everyone here today feel your love, feel your grace, feel your favor. Know that, God, we can be forgiven. You can deal with our hearts, challenge our lives, speak into our souls. Every head bowed, every eye closed, nobody moving around. Some of the great conversions come when we preach on subjects like this. You say, man, if you preach that, nobody's going to get saved, but they do. Because it's God who's here. And he's able to convict the heart of a sinner or an unbeliever or a backslider that may be sitting here today. Even though I preached a sermon on finances and money, I have mentioned salvation. You know that you need to be saved. You know that you need to be forgiven. You know that you need God's grace and God's love and God's blessing and God's favor. So I want to ask you, putting everything else aside for a moment, you're here today, this morning, and you're not saved. You're not right with God. You do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but you do want to know him. Know him. That means something. It's not religion. We don't come to church just because of a theory. We come here because we love him. We know him. We've been forgiven of our sins. He's established his presence in our hearts. Thank you so much, my God, for the day of my conversion, for your wonderful love. That love is here today. That love is here to touch anyone who doesn't know it. Anyone who's caught up in sin and you're lonely and empty and broken. There are so many here, I'm sure, that need forgiveness. You need God's love and grace. Would you let me help you? And in order to help you, I want to pray for you. I can do that. In order to do that, I need you to do one simple thing. I'd like you to just lift your hand. Pastor, I want prayer. I need forgiveness. I want to know the God that you're talking about, the one who loves me and can forgive my sin and change my life. Would you lift your hand right now? Let me pray for you. Lift it up. Every head bowed, nobody looking. Lift your hand right up in the name of Jesus. I know I need to repent, and I want to get my heart right with God. Lift your hand. Please let me pray for you. It's so simple. It really is. You feel God's love. You know you're a sinner. The only thing left to do is for you to pray. God, I know you're real. I know I'm lost. I know you died for my sins. That's all. And receive him as your Savior. Would you let me pray for you? Lift your hand. Lift it up. Lift it up. Anyone. Maybe you're backslidden. Maybe this sermon has brought to light the fact that you're backslidden. It's more King of Sodom than King of Salem, for sure. You're not right with God. You're not right with God. You can't serve two gods, Jesus says. You can't serve two masters, God or mammon, one or the other. You're backslidden. This is the proof and the evidence of it. Disobedience in this area, but that's, of course, connected with other things. Sin and immorality and various types of compromise that you enact. Levels of disobedience that you think are normal and natural and have become the new norm in your life. You're not right. And you need to rededicate your life to Christ. I wonder, would you have the courage to lift your hand and let me pray for you? All over this building. In the name of Jesus. Lift your hand right up. Oh, God. God, I pray for climate change in our church and in our city. A new dimension of repentance and brokenness, God. Sinners, backsliders, compromisers, responding at these altars, oh God. All of us are going to interact with the kings of Salem and Sodom. It happens every time we get paid, every time resource and wealth comes. What do you think of first? Let me ask you that. What do you think of first? The king of Sodom says, think of yourself. I want souls, you keep the money. The king of Salem, who is the source of Abraham's blessing. Abraham thinks of him first and separates a tenth to honor him. I want to challenge you today. No matter what your status is, you may be a faithful tither. You belong at this altar to reaffirm and reestablish that decision. We decide beforehand, not when. If you wait till when, the king of Sodom is going to have the upper hand to get you to think about yourself first. We come to an altar saying, God, it's going to be first fruits. It's going to be tithing. No matter how often, how much, or how little you bless me with, I'm separating a tenth. You may be already doing that faithfully. I want you to reestablish that. There are others here that you are not a tither. This may be the very first sermon you've heard on the subject of tithing, and God is really dealing with you. You've gotten saved. You've given your heart to Jesus. And this is a natural progression of what God is doing in your life. And you're going to come to this altar saying, yes, Lord. Yes. And then there are others, you've had a revelation of tithing. Somewhere along the road, the king of Sodom got to you. That's what's happened. The king of Salem is inspired of God. The king of Sodom is inspired of hell. And he got to you. And it's easy to get to us. Sometimes we're human. We rationalize. We have needs. All kinds of things play out. Once you compromise in that area, it's not long before a compromise happens in other areas. And there are others that are here that God is dealing with you about your primary objective in life. It's not to make money. God bless you. I want every businessman to flourish. I pray for the businessmen and the salesmen and the wage earners, those that are wanting to start a business. God bless you, but don't let that become your God. Don't let that become your objective to the point where you compromise his will, because that will happen eventually. If money is the objective, that's going to happen eventually. You need to get your heart right at this altar and establish yourself as a man or woman who's going to prioritize pursuing the will of God above all else. Let's all stand. Altar's open. We're not going to sing. I want everyone to come and pray at this altar. Slip out of your seat. This should be a unanimous response at the altar here today by the membership of this congregation. There are people that are coming forward for salvation. There are backsliders that God is dealing with. I want you to consecrate yourself to God. God, it's going to be your will above every other pursuit of life, every other course, every other direction, every other desire, every other craving, every other appetite. These altars are open. You're coming to declare that Jesus is the Lord of your life. You're coming to consecrate yourself to the will of God. It requires a response. God, touch every heart. Father, minister to every life. I pray for the spirit of revelation right now, Lord, to be at work, that we're not speaking words of philosophy. We're speaking words of revelation that come from your word. Let that word resonate in every heart. Oh, God, let there be repentance here at this altar. Let there be surrender to your word and your will at this altar. I thank you, Jesus. Oh, God, you're worthy to be praised and glorified and exalted. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you so much, oh God, that you are my provider. You are my source. You are my all in all. You are my ever-present help in time of trouble. And I trust you, oh God, and the demonstration of my trust and my love is the tithe. I honor you, oh God, with that in Jesus' name. I want us all to stand, if you would, please. And I want you to remain standing at the altar with every head bowed and every eye closed, please. Nobody looking around. Give people privacy to respond to God as he's dealing with them. Every head bowed, every eye closed. In Jesus' name. First of all, there are people here that you're a faithful tither. And what you need to do in this altar call, every head bowed, please, every eye closed. What you need to do at this altar call is reaffirm that, because you may be a faithful tither, but the king of Sodom is alive and well, and he does still come knocking. And we want to reiterate, as Abraham, I raise my hand to the Most High God. You're going to raise your hand tonight, to this morning, reaffirming your decision. I'm going to be a tither, and I'm deciding now that whenever money comes into my hand, God's going to get a tenth. I want you to lift your hand. You're already doing this, but you're going to reaffirm this at the altar. In the name of Jesus, you're going to reaffirm this at the altar. Most every hand going up. Most every hand going up. Okay, you can put those hands down. There are others that are here that you don't tithe, and you don't tithe like my wife and I didn't tithe. We weren't saved. We first came into the church. Took a little while, not long, for us to hear about it, and then we started practicing it. You're not a tither. You may be a newer member, or you may have been around a while, but you haven't grasped, why should I? I give a little bit here and a little bit there. It's not a tithe. A tithe is first fruits. It's the first you get your paycheck. It's God first, not bills and everything else, and then see what I got left over. The tithe is 10%. Calculated and honoring God. So you don't do that. This sermon has helped you. And while our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, you want to lift your hand to the Most High God and say, you know what? I'm going to begin to tithe and obey God and honor him. I want you to lift your hand right now. Amen. God bless you. Anyone else, lift your hands up. Many hands going up. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And then there are those here that you have been a tither, and you were a tither by revelation. You heard sermons like this. You felt conviction, and you said, God, I want to do that. You saved me from hell. You forgave my sins. I mean, tithing should be instinctual. It's the least we can do. It's not actually giving. It's giving God what he takes possession, what he claims that he owns anyway. Not tithing is called in the Bible robbing God. But somewhere along the line, the king of Sodom got to you, convinced you to keep it for yourself. And God's dealing with you. You're repenting. You're going to take advantage of this first month of the year to get this right. And you're going to lift your hand to the Most High God right now and say, I'm returning to this principle. I want you to lift your hand. Amen. Numbers of people. It happens. King of Sodom has a powerful influence. Appeals to our nature. Pray this prayer. God in heaven, I thank you this morning for grace and love and provision and abundance. I thank you for the money and the wealth and the resources that you have put in my hands. I acknowledge you as my source in all things, and I make a decision. I am yielding myself and all of my resources to the King of Salem, separating a tenth to honor God, and liberality besides that, offerings and pledges besides, but it all begins with tithing. 10% of all that I earn, all that comes to me, I'm separating to honor God, to demonstrate my love and my trust. And Lord, I thank you for the dividends that you have made available. For I know that if I tithe, revelation comes, you get close, and you take control of my financial interests. And I'm doing that from this day forward. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Father, seal this word in every heart and in every life. I want you to pray before God and seal this before him. Father, seal this word. God, bring revelation to every heart. Oh, God, thank you, Lord. God, we honor you and praise you and exalt you, glorify you and worship you. If you need to and you can, you bring a tithe tonight. If it's your first one and you have it, you bring it tonight or at the soonest. There's a whole principle. I didn't inject it into the sermon. There's a whole principle in the Bible of first fruits. That means the first. When you get the whole, the 100%, 10 is immediately separated for God. And then you have the 90 to deal with however you need to. We make that commitment in Jesus' name. We're going to just dismiss right now in prayer. I went a little tiny bit long with the sermon and the altar call, but we're going to dismiss and pray. Don't forget the big wedding tonight. Looking very much forward to that. Gabriel and Melissa, it's going to be a powerful time. So you come back tonight, bring someone that needs Jesus. Remember, we'll be having our evening prayer meeting at 5:30 here in the sanctuary because of the wedding, and we're going to pray from 5:30 to about 6 or maybe a few minutes past 6 because people will be coming in. So come early to pray tonight, or at least come on time to pray and lay hold of God, and we're going to look forward to a great time. Our heads are bowed. We're going to dismiss in prayer and thank God for all that he's doing. And I want to ask if our brother Gabriel Rangel would close us in prayer today. Amen. God love you. God bless you. We'll see you tonight.